I want to remember, because I like to review each week a little bit, okay? Kids, help me out with this. The first week, why is Passover important to our discussion here? Why is Passover important to the to our understanding of Holy Communion? Go ahead, Will. You get to answer this one. Otherwise, the rest of them are on, because they're just going to wait for you to answer this question. Okay, did you hear that? The Lord's Supper is kind of like Passover. Good, stop there. Why? Who else can answer? Matthew, help me out, buddy. Why is the Passover like the Lord's Supper? What does Jesus say about the wine?
This is blood.
What does John the Baptist say about Jesus? Yes. What is it?
Lamb of God.
Lamb of God, who does something, who takes away the sins of the world, right? Okay, very good. So Passover, right? This is my blood. That's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus is the Passover Lamb. Got it? Right? Jesus is the Passover Lamb who saves us from death. Jesus, so in second session, I ask this question. Why is it important that we understand that Jesus' body and blood are present? What would you say? If I say, why is it important to understand that you can't? I told you. You had one bite at the apple, everybody. No, thank you, Will. I appreciate the participating. I mean, I'm sorry. Thanks for letting me teach you. That's nice of you. Why is it important that we believe that Jesus' body and blood are present in the bread and wine? Why? Gabby? Perfect. Exactly. Right? You remember that? On Ash Wednesday, I may ask you that question. And I might call you by name, just so you know. I may say, Lyric, why is it important that we believe that Jesus' body and blood are present with the bread and wine and Holy Communion? And you would say, because if Jesus is there, what would you say? Then his gifts are there. Now, let your brain engage for just a minute. Let your brain kick in. If Jesus is there, then he can do what he says, right? You get what I'm saying? If we just imagine that he's there, and he's not there to do what he says, but if Jesus is there, he can do what he says, right? So like if the king is present, the king can do what the king says, right? If the dentist is present in the office, he can fix your cavity. If the surgeon is there and needs to take your appendix out, he can take your appendix out if he's there. If he ain't there, he can't take it out. Do you get what I'm saying? This is why this is significant. It's awesome. Because if Jesus is present here at this meal, then we know that his gifts are there too. That is very cool. Because then I'm coming. I want to come. If it's only symbolic, then it's just, it's not that significant. It's just not that important. But if he's really there, what a blessing, right? What a blessing. So we love to be able to take Jesus at his word when he says, this is my body, this is my blood. Okay, third one, what kind of a meal is it? Is this a meal like a restaurant? It's more a meal like what? Yes, correct. A meal at home where who do we invite? Who's always invited at home, right?
Your family
is invited, right? Now you can invite other people to it too, can't you? You kind of welcome them into your family, don't you? So even at Holy Communion, sometimes there are guests and things like that. We invite our family members and we invite those to come in. But it's not like a restaurant where just anybody does it. Now, how does God make you part of his family? In baptism. Okay, go to session 4. Session 4, and this will be simple and pretty easy. In session 4, so here, look on page 15. So the question we're asking there, after we talked last week, and the reason I ask you this question is because Holy Communion is similar. In Holy Communion, who's doing the work? Who's doing the things that provide blessings to you? No, not the priest. God does. God is doing the things that bring that to you, right? So Jesus is saying, I'm present here, and so I bring you gifts of forgiveness and eternal life, okay? And strength. In baptism, we believe the same thing is happening. God is coming into the water in order to do things that he promised to do, okay? So this is important to us because communion is the same way. In other words, so parents, you may have to help reinforce this, but this is a little bit higher concept. If in communion, we're just coming up and we're being obedient, right? Jesus said, come to Holy Communion. So I should kind of pray and I should be reverent. And if I come, then good. Did a religious thing. Right? God doesn't care about that. God doesn't care about being about a religious thing. God is saying, I've got a banquet for you, and I want to meet you with my gifts. And that's why I want you to come. I want you to come because I have something to give you. This is important. And so baptism and Holy Communion are those things that we call sacraments in the Bible. God is inviting us to come to those things because he has something important to give you. And so in baptism, look on page 16. These three things, and you know these, and you can read about this and have it explained a little more. But remember when I'm in church, I quiz you. I say there's three great things that God gives you. The first one is God puts his name on you, right? So Gabby has had this, receive the sign of the Holy Cross upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one who's been redeemed by Christ the Crucified. When if you go through confirmation, that's what happens in your confirmation. You come up, remembering your baptism, receive the sign of the Holy Cross, right? You've been marked by Christ. He's put his name on you. When God puts his name on you, you are what? When you have God's name, you are family. And then, because you're family, now think about it this way. If you're an employee, so I used to work at Burger King way back in the day. What if I showed up late 3 days in a row? What do you think would happen? What do you think?
You'd like probably get a warning that you might get fired.
Probably the first time I'd get a warning. What would happen maybe the second time? Or the third time? You get fired. So I go to the boss and say, I'm really sorry, my car wouldn't start, the dog threw up, you know, whatever I want to say, right? I'm really sorry I'm late. But by the third time, what does the boss say? He says, I can find someone else to do this gig, okay? I can find someone else to do that work. But it isn't that way in a family, is it? I go to my parents, and I was a kid just like you, it may seem impossible. But I would go, I remember once I bought this, my mom bought me these new pair of sneakers, told me not to go outside and play, and I played, and they were filthy. And my mom was unhappy. And I felt so bad. I really did. I wasn't defiant. I just said, I was a kid, you know, I didn't notice. I went out and played, and I just got all muddy and messed up. And I went to my mom, and I knew she was mad. And I said, Mom, I am so sorry. I just really blew it. I'm really sorry. What can I do? And she forgave me, didn't she? I mean, did I get punished a little bit? You know, yeah, I got punished a little bit. But she forgave me. She said, we'll get you new shoes. We'll make sure that works out. But she forgave me. Why? I wasn't her employee. Why did she forgive me?
Because you were her family.
Yeah, because I was her child, right? So God, the second great gift that baptism gives us is what? Forgiveness, right? And it's because we're part of his family. See, God forgives us as his family. And then the third thing is, we also get the Holy Spirit, and God gives us faith, right? So those three great gifts come in baptism, but because we're part of his family, God invites us to this table so that we can receive gifts to strengthen us in our living. See, in baptism, you only get baptized once, don't you? You only get, because if God's doing it, God does it once, and we're going to go. And so we get baptized, but Holy Communion, you come all the time, don't you? Now, do you think there could be a... How often do you think we should go to communion? Let's think about that. Aiden, what do you think?
Like every time we feel like we need to get
baptized. Okay, that's a great answer. So how often would that be?
Okay.
Yeah, that's a great answer. In fact, it might be 3 times a day. Every day. But it's a great question. When I feel like I want to be sure of God's grace, I want to know that I'm forgiven, and it's offered. In other words, what do you think? Do you think that's too much? Do it every day? Now think about it for a minute. What if you did it every day? What if it became... Yeah. What if it became unimportant? Like, do any of you know the Lord's Prayer?
Yeah.
You have it memorized?
Yeah.
Have you ever found yourself saying it and not thinking about it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ooh, you're honest. Thank you for being honest. Even me, I'm the pastor. Every once in a while in church, I go, oh, Lord, I'm thinking about the choir doing this. I'm thinking about that. I go, oh, Lord, I'm sorry. Because it becomes so common. So here's what we do here, right? We do it every other Sunday. But if you want to have it every Sunday, you could. You just have to go back and forth between the two different kinds of services. And you could have communion every Sunday if you want. So in the Catholic Church, They have it every time, every day. The Mass is available every day. That's a big deal. Now, when my daddy was growing up, he's old, he was born in 1917. When my dad was growing up, they had it four times a year. Four times a year. And then when they went to once a month, a bunch of people left the church because they thought that was abusive. That was too much. And so when I was a kid growing up, we kind of had it twice a month. And so the idea is this. We want to provide access to it for you all the time. So let's say you go through the week and you're struggling. You had a blowout. And then you said, Lord, I want to ask for your forgiveness. And you go on Sunday and you say, well, I have to go to 8:30 and I have communion. Or I go to 11 o'clock and have communion. We want to make it accessible to you. So we want it to have it often. But we don't want you to do it so much that it becomes habit or that you don't even think about it. So that's a balance. That's our challenge. Okay, now, last thing I want to talk to you about here is look on page 19. So look at this. This one is, now how do you prepare? So you're sitting here and we have communion. And you know it's going to be communion because, this is great. Thank you, Mrs. Stokes, if you're still around. Thank you, Mrs. Stokes. Okay. So you can always tell there's going to be, here, come on up here. Everybody come on up. Kids, around the altar. And then parents, you can come up too. Come on, come on, come on. You're good. I want you to come up too. Hang out. Oh, bring your book too. Go grab your book, please. So, you know, this is a really interesting space in the church, isn't it? You know, we have names for different places in the church. Do you know that? So, like here, like, you know that rail there, what that is called? It has a couple of names. It can be called a communion rail or an altar rail. This is an altar. This right here is an altar. You can tell there's communion when these two candles are lit and you see something here covered in a white cloth. And then you know there's communion that Sunday when you come in. Or at 11 o'clock, it's the second and the fourth Sundays, and at 8:30, it's first and third Sundays. So that area we sit out there can be called a sanctuary. It has a more formal name called a nave. And then you have that lobby area out there. Its formal name is narthex. There's all kinds of names in the church. And all of this stuff here has names also. So when we come up to the altar, we like to do this from behind the altar. It's nice that the altar steps out. In some older churches or like little country churches, the altar would be right up against the wall. So the pastor did everything with his back to people. And here, you guys can come farther around here. Ellie, come around here. Jacob, come on around here. I want kids closer. As close as you can. You should be able to touch this. So So what we ask you to do is, like, inside this rail, we really do ask you to act with some respect, right? This is a place, because there aren't many places in our life now that are kind of holy places, set apart places. And so we don't ever want you to think that we worship carpet or wood or anything like that. You know what I mean? So they say, oh, you can't touch that. But you can touch things respectfully. Right? And we can use them well. Like I tell people in our church all the time, I want to wear out our buildings. I want to wear them out. It means we used them so much. Right? So I would love to wear out this because we had communion so much and had so many people here. So when we come to this place, it's appropriate that we prepare, right? So just like if you have a test, do you prepare for a test?
Yeah.
Or if you go to Disneyland, do you prepare? Bring some sunscreen. Yeah. You pack a bag,
yeah.
Right? You wear get the right shoes so you're not wearing flip-flops the whole time and kill yourself, right? So you know what I mean? You prepare for all those things. We should prepare for communion too. So do you see this in your book? Here, I'll leave that here. You can read this one. So look at this. When we sit in the pew, so we sit there, and unless you sit right in the front, you're going to have time. You're going to have a little bit of time. And so we sing, right? And the whole service prepares us for communion. So what do you think, this is unfair of me, but do you think there's anything in the service that helps us prepare that you can think of? What are we receiving here? What do we receive? Christ's body and blood. Why? What are we receiving? What's the gift he's giving?
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness of sins. So, what do you think happens in the service? Correct. We have a part where we confess our sins and we're forgiven. Right? That's preparing. And then we read scripture, right? About Jesus and about God's word. And that prepares us. We hear a sermon that tells us about God's love for us and our response to his love. That prepares us. And then we have prayers, and if we have communion, the pastor always prays, prepare us, prepare our hearts, so that when we come, we can receive your gifts. And then we hope that you will personally prepare. This is what this is. So here, you can look at this. So the first thing is, ooh, I spelled that wrong. Wow. No living. Anyway, the first thing is to say, I know I'm a sinner, right? That's the first thing. If we don't say that, then why would you come, right? If you're coming for the forgiveness of sins, but you don't need to be forgiven. If you think you don't need to be forgiven, now I'm being serious with you, please don't come. If you don't think you need forgiveness in your life, please don't come. That would be an offense to the one who is offering forgiveness to you. But if you think you would like forgiveness for any reason, then we want you to come. Even if you're sitting there struggling, going, boy, I haven't been a good kid this week, and I wonder if I should go. You don't go because you deserve to go. You go because you need to go. Okay? So the time not to come is when you think you don't need it. Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
The person who's worthy to come to communion is the person who knows they're not worthy. That's the interesting thing of this. Okay, so the first thing is to say, I'm a sinner. The second thing, you're looking at your book, then we say, Lord, I want to do a 180-degree turn, right? Repent. Remember, that's what that means. We say, Lord, I'm sorry for that, and I trust in you to save me. This is like a prayer, right? Third one is, then we say, Lord, I am grateful that you're there and your gifts are there. I'm grateful that you're there. Fourth thing is, Lord, I want to change, right? Help me to change. It's not really asking for forgiveness if we say, I'm sorry, but I want to keep doing it. You understand that? Like, you know, I'm copying my friend's math homework every Thursday, and the teacher hasn't found out for like a month. And you go, I know it's wrong, so I'm really sorry for it, but I plan to do it again next Thursday. That doesn't count. That's not actually being repentant, is it? Right? So we say, Lord, help me change. I want you to change my heart. Help me to be nicer to my sister or my brother. Help me to be more obedient. And then the fifth thing is to say thank you. Thanks for the gifts you gave. So, this is a thing. Parents, if you want to, you can cut it out. You can put it on a little card. You can bring it along with you. Stick it in the hymnal. Put it in your Bible. Never hurts. So that's how this prayer goes, right? Lord, I know that I need your grace. I know that I can only find it in you. I'm thankful that you are present there with your body and blood to forgive me. I want to change my life, and I pray that you'll help me change my life, and I want to live with joy. That's the prayer. Okay? All right. Now, let me show you this stuff. Please just go back. Cool. So, all of these things have names. We set this up. This is how it goes. Oh, yeah, okay, good. This is called a chalice, and this is called a flagon. So we fill that up with wine. We don't fill it too much because it can get messy. We have to be careful. And so this is bread, right? So it's unleavened bread. It's flat. It's very boring and simple, but it's actually bread. This here is gluten-free. So if you have a gluten problem, please know that that's available to you. Now, normally, the pastor will come and put this in your hand, right? And we'll say, take and eat. But with gluten, we want you to take it because we've been touching all the other gluten stuff. So we would rather you take it, okay? But only take this if you need it. I mean, if you really need it, not because it would be cool to try it. So that would be good. And then here, so there's two ways that you can receive the cup. So this we call the host. Bread, and this is the cup, or the wine. Jesus took the cup after supper, right? So inside here, you know what this is?
Grape juice.
That's grape juice, correct. And then this is wine on the outside. It's not fancy, you guys. It's like the cheapest wine there is. It's funny, though. People will come by and say, oh, that communion wine was so good. What is it? I want to get some for home, you know, like for dinner. No, you actually don't. It's like Thunderbird. It's Manischewitz. I mean, it's okay, you can get it. It's my Manischewitz Concord grape. It's about sweet. But it's funny, for communion, it actually works really well because it's just a little bit. Just a little bit. And this is a conversation, parents. This is a conversation for you. We would not offer it in any of these forms if it was wrong. So we think this all is appropriate and right and biblical and honors Christ. So if your kid needs to take gluten-free, that's great. So alert us, help us know, help us out. I tell people it's okay to talk up there as long as you're not talking to each other. You can talk to me. And we can, and you can ask your kids something. I mean, if it's something about this, why don't you want you coming up talking about the Seahawks or something? You know, or about some cute boy three rows back, right? I mean, that's what we don't want to do. But I want you to have a conversation with your kids about what you want to do, okay? So you take, we give you the host, and then some form of this. And grape juice is completely appropriate. If you say, I don't want my kid to have this before a certain age, all good. But there's so little of this, please know it's not going to affect you. Now, this is a common cup, right? Oh, and another, why do you think we offer grape juice, by the way? Did you answer that one?
Yeah.
Why?
Because some people are like non-alcoholics.
Right, so people struggling with an alcohol addiction, just even the smallest amount can be too scary. Yeah. And we don't want to cause anyone to sin. So we want to help them in that situation. So we're trying to be faithful to God's word and compassionate to people at the same time. So this one, we put wine in this. A lot of people think this is really gross. But what's interesting is it's really pretty safe. It's very safe. It's just as safe as anything else. Because, why? Why? What makes it safe? The same reason that Jesus just and his disciples put wine in their water. Why did they put wine in their water? Why?
To purify it.
What would purify it?
The wine.
The alcohol, right? So the alcohol is a cleansing agent, right? So the alcohol in here, our church body, because we still use a common cup, which a lot of people think is gross, and it's all good if you think it's gross, but it's we do studies every few years that just remind people it's all good. So this is how it happens. The person will come by with this, with the bread, and then come by with this. So take one or the other, and then come by with this. Don't try to take one of each, all right? So, but if you want this, then we actually ask you to kind of help, right? Don't ask the elder to try to pour it in your mouth, okay? But this is more common for older folks because there was a time when we never didn't offer this, that this was all there was. It's probably 30 years ago now. When this was all there was. But the elder comes by and you may drink a little bit and you just take a little sip, right? And then the elder wipes it and turns the cup. Wipes and turns. Wipes and turns. I use both. Because what's funny is I know sometimes people are watching the pastor, what's he doing? Loser, right? We're gonna do this. You know, and so I make sure I use both of these. But this is what I grew up with, and I like it because I like that we drink from the same cup. Not in a gross way, like sharing a grape knee-high, but I mean, or sharing a Coke, but I mean, it's really more like it's the same cup that we participate in, and it's very much like what Jesus did. But there's no wrong way, okay, just so you know. No wrong way. It's all good. Parents, you figure it out. And you do it. Okay. Questions on anything you see up here? Nope? Well?
What's in that container?
In this one, that's extra. We put extra in here because at 11 we run out. And we have to put more on there.
Okay.
Yep, that's what we do. Okay? Okay, kids, kneel at the altar. Parents, you can go ahead and sit down. Kneel at the altar rail. Here, Ryan, help me. John, come in. Take the common cup. Have you taken the common cup? Okay, so here's how it goes, everybody, right? Oh, you're good this side. We're good. Yeah, so here's how we do it at our church. By faith, I think when you guys have communion, you all stand up and then the pastor asks and everybody waits until they're all up there and then you kneel. I'm pretty sure that's how it goes, right? And then you wait until you're done serving and then the pastor or the deacon will say something and then you all leave at the same time. At Grace, you come in right and you fill in. And so we keep it going continuously and then do something at the end. So when you come in, you always start here and we fill in this way, right? So we go that way. You come, you don't wait. You go ahead and kneel. And then here's what I need you to do for me. Hold that, son. And here's what I need you to do. This is important. Please hold your hand out. If you can hold your hand up like this, that would be ideal. Because sometimes I go to people and I've got to find a way to sneak that baby in there somewhere. I don't know how to get it in. I need you to kind of let me know you want to receive. So it's helpful to me if you do that. So we come along, right? So first we come along and we will say, take and eat. I'm not going to give you any now. We're going to wait. But take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. So you take it and then you go ahead and eat it right away. And so as we go along. And then we'll come the individual cup. And you can take either the grape juice or that. If you don't want to take it, you don't have to make any motions. Or if you want this one, just wait. He'll go by. And then if you want this common cup, you will take that. So it's rare for a kid to take a common cup. But do it if you want. Don't worry about it. One way or the other. Okay? So when you come, I'm assuming you're mostly going to come up with your parents. And so again, we want you to be respectful. Right? I don't need you to look like somebody died, although somebody did die for you, but he rose again. And that's why he's present here with us now. So Jesus is not dead. Our God is alive. And so we want to be respectful, and he comes to you with his living presence now. Okay? So we want you to be respectful. So I don't want you to goof around. Don't goof around in the line, lining up. Use that as a time to think, too. You can sing. There might be songs, stuff like that. So come and be respectful, but you don't have to act as if, you know, I hate this and this is horrible. We want you to know that you're receiving Christ, and in receiving Christ, you receive your gifts. That's as simple as it is. I hope it blesses you. Questions? And then when you're done, you can get up and go. You can go back to your seats and pray. You can pray here, by the way. I tell people, you stay here as long as you want. We'll work around. We do. We have all kinds of people that come linger. Oh, yeah, there it is.
You guys, after you're done with the wine, you can just put your cups up right there. And all those stuff. And it's fine to stack them. If you're out of spots.
But you don't need to stack everybody's cups. We leave that for the 2-year-olds. The 3-year-olds.
They're good at it.
They are good at it. And they love it. So we have to leave that cake for them. Questions? You're good? Parents? Questions? Okay, it would be great. We're going to reserve seats for you guys on Ash Wednesday. So I would love to know if you call in the office, if you have any people coming who will be sitting with you, extended family, grandparents, godparents, you are welcome to. We'll reserve as many seats as you want if you let us know. But we'll reserve seats because we want the First Communion families and kids. And we want you to do this with your kids, right? I mean, this, you do this, it's a family meal. So just let us know. Call in. And I'll tell you, it would bless my wife if you would call in and say, let's make sure we got the spelling right. Because she'll tell you, here's how we want to print this. We try to make this not a big deal. This is kind of a big deal. No, we really think it's a big deal, actually. So anyway, if you would call in to Teresa and then have me give a spelling, or if you want an email, that's okay too.
But that would help. And if we get that done this week, that'll help us even more. Because it's the following week that's Ash Wednesday. It's a big service, a lot of people. We'll get as many as 300 people. And so we do the imposition of ashes, which is not required, by the way. We don't make people do stuff, right? But if you want it, we'll have stations where we do this imposition of ashes. So for some people, it's way too Catholic, which is funny because it's not really Catholic, it's Jewish. Because that's what Jewish people do. Anyway, you guys can get up. Sorry. If I kneel too long, I can't get up. Are you good? Questions? So come maybe 15 minutes early if you can, and then you'll get a seat.
you know, you can come half hour early if you want. Okay? All right. Let's, I want to say a prayer for you guys. Lord God, I thank you for the time that we've had together with these students, for their families. Coming to the Lord's table, Lord, is a great honor and a great joy. You intended it for our joy and to bless us with your own presence and the promise of your gifts. So, Lord, help us always to come by faith and to receive you as you promise, so that we can be strengthened, Lord, so that we can be filled with your grace, so that we can follow you out of joy and thanksgiving. And so, Lord, bless these families, and especially these kids who have learned about you and your gifts. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, that's good.